All right. Welcome back, dear viewers, to Session 31, Lamentations of Elemental Evil. Last session was more of a role-playing session as the party learned all kinds of stuff going on in the Moat House and in the temple, specifically that there is a demon goddess of fungi probably manifesting herself in the temple, and hence the zombified mushrooms and various other strangeness corrupting the land. The party is currently awaiting Burn, the wizard of Hamlet, to figure out a way to combat these advanced, very powerful zombie mushroom things. And in the meantime, they decide to head back to Rick Rom's Inn, see what else they can find, considering they were in, I think, they got into one room the last time they were there, once they uncovered the dungeon. They've also buried about 150 gold pieces there, hoping to bring it back and get some more XP, I'm sure. Right before they got there was an attack by some bandits. Bandits that have been plaguing the North Road for some time. And the bandit leader had a map on him that pointed to where their camp is, and it's this little X beneath this big red N. So the party now knows where they are. And as a reminder to the party, these are the same bandits that took the many barrels of gunpowder ordered by Dagus and the prior crew. I think there's a few other items that you guys were hoping to get. So there's that. And let us get back to Rick Rom's Inn. Where is it? Oh, there's the image. Oh, there it is. All right. You gonna park the carts near the well again?
Hey, let's park them. Yeah, that's probably best, because we don't want to get too close to them bats.
I mean, there is a stable. I mean, there are literal stables. We could stable the animals and the stuff, which would also be out of sight, too. You know, out of sight, out of mind, if we want to compare orcs to, like, toddlers. It doesn't exist if they don't see it.
I'm down for the stables. It's not like there's any traps or mosquito bats.
Horses go into stables.
Yeah, I agree with getting everything under cover. I think, how many times did we get raided when they were out in the open? It was like three times in one
yes.
day.
Yes. And no giant plumes of smoke this time.
That is true. Oh, yeah. Yeah, instead of bodies surrounding that central statue, it's just a lot of smudged marks. I mean, it's rained, you know, so it's relatively clean, but there's no bodies.
Bone chunks.
Yeah. Some of the remains that didn't burn up.
Was there any gear in this pile? Like any daggers poking out or spearheads?
No.
Nope. Gone.
No. Just a lot of burned up stuff. Useless. What would you guys like to do once you stable the animals?
We should first get the gold pieces or see if anything's entered there or taken any before we continue on.
I thought maybe we'd check and see if we got all those bats out of the way too, maybe.
Those things again. Yes. And Gilbert will raise sword and shield nice and high. Prepared for combat.
Okay. Well, entering into the inn, if you recall, you had set up some of the bodies of those bandits that tried to jump you as you left around the tables. You see them, the bodies are there, but they have, like, been knocked over, slumped over, some are on the floor, and they all bear the signs of being drained. They, you know, pinpricks, and they're basically all their bodily fluids have been sucked clean.
Desiccated corpses. I like it.
Oh yeah, and they are rotting, so it does stink in here.
Ew.
Oh, we going downstairs?
Yeah, do you guys remember where you put your 150 gold pieces?
Yeah, in the secret room.
Yep, yeah, yeah. Remember, it was in the basement behind the secret room in a special thing so that no one else but us would know of it.
Ah, special thing.
Yes.
Can you describe this special thing?
Is it a rusty iron box?
Yeah, I think it was the rusty iron box, and then we put it either behind, underneath a desk, or in a cupboard, or something like that. You guys would remember this, where, so that way it wouldn't be obvious if someone got in there, unless they knew where to look. So, we'll probably be making our, unless someone says otherwise, we're probably gonna be making our way to that room, researching it, and getting our gold.
You are pretty much correct. I was gonna be pretty strict about you remembering where you put it.
Well, I mean, if you want me, if it's pretty much correct, you can be a little strict with us.
But no.
YouTube. Watch the old episode.
But yes, after maybe like a half hour, you know, maneuvering back, because it's dark, you gotta light the torch or your lantern or whatever. You make it into the secret room, and you find it. It's pretty easy, you know. It's there. You have your 150 gold pieces. More money than you've probably, aside from the first haul when you were here the last time. But in total, this is the most money you've seen in your entire life. Probably 10 lifetimes.
Given what little silver he started with, and given how most of that had to get spent on weapons and armor, for Gilbert at least, absolutely.
All right. So, did you want to head back up to the attic to see if there's any more mosquito bats?
Wait.
Or did you?
We should form a plan first. Gilbert will look to, he will look to Franz and ask, if we're gonna fight the mosquito bats, how are we gonna do it?
Well, they haven't bothered us yet. Let's just go down they might mess with the animals. Try that funeral fog bit again. That worked pretty well.
Wait a minute. Since we do know that the real treasure, the honeypot, is actually underneath the statue, we could always just burn down the inn. Unless you guys really wanting to claim it, we could just raise it.
If we claim the inn, we could make more money later, right?
If we make a fire, the bandits will come.
Yes.
Yeah, we gotta fight the bandits too.
Better to fight them on our own terms.
What if we just board up the stairs and the hole in the roof and they can suck each other dry?
Suck each other dry.
Yeah.
You guys are all 13. But I'm 17, so what do I know?
My sister claims I'm 12.
Yeah, 13's pretty good, honestly.
My sister says I had the brain of a 6-year-old, but I think that might be a bit mean. And then as a little butterfly passes by, he like falls it with his eyes. Ooh, butterfly.
All right, well, there's two plans on the table. Ignore the bats and head down into the dungeon, or I guess plug up the hole in the roof.
What if we cast the funeral fog into the roof, and that way they'll kill each other?
That could work if there's enough of them.
Hmm.
Also, I think that spell is centered on me, so I would have to be in there with them.
I'm okay with that.
Is there any planks or stuff available so we could seal it up and nail up the hole?
We got tables and chairs down here, right?
There are. As far as planks lying about, probably not. And if there were, they've been outside, you know, exposed to the elements. They probably are not in the greatest of shape anyway.
How big is the hole, actually?
The hole is... let's see. Well, it is, I would say a big enough for a man-sized person to crawl through, not walk through. So, you know, a swarm of bats, mosquito bats, can easily, like, swarm in and out. And, you know, you can actually sort of see it, because it's not just on the roof, but it's also part of the wall coming down.
And we could tarp it, guys. We could find something like a tarp, or use a bunch of blankets, nail them up, and that would make it harder for them to get out. They could probably still get out if they really, really wanted to. The other option is go up there and kill them. So you just got to figure out what you want to do. If the critters are in the barn and we seal the barn up, they shouldn't be able to get into the barn if we make it to where stuff couldn't fly into it.
We'll protect the horses in the barn, and then we'll pick a fight with whatever of them are down here with the fog, and we'll stay out of the fog so we can ping whatever jumps out.
Like it.
Yeah, you think it's a good idea?
Sounds good.
Yeah.
So what are you doing?
Do you want me down there outside the hole with a pole arm? Is that what we're doing? And he's going to go up and funeral fog him?
I can hang out with you with a bow.
I also should probably switch out the sword and board for a bow, but I am wondering if firing into fog might be a bit of a bad idea.
Yeah, it worked every other time.
Alright, in that case, before we start, Gilbert will swap back his sword and shield for the short bow and quiver.
I like your style.
I'll just be low crawling in the fog. So
yeah, good thinking.
Three-quarter covers.
So I'll be sniping outside the range of the fog. Hans or Franz has the pole arm. The goblin will be sneaking underneath the fog and arrowing as well. The elf will be a complete Chad. And then, what are the other two guys doing?
Yeah, Hans and Franz are going to flank the hole. And anything comes out of the hole, we're going to poke it. We're going to poke anything in the hole. Pokey pokey the hole.
We're going to poke anything.
Come outside, then we poke you up.
We're going to poke you off.
I'm sorry, are you going to poke him or are you going to pork him? Because there's a very big distinction there.
Yes. Yes.
Mosquito man bats.
Yes.
Oh my god. All right. So.
13 to 12.
The two of you are outside.
I was planning on going outside, yes.
Oh, and the goblin. Okay, and Gar. So Gar, Hans, and Franz will be outside, yeah.
We're going to be pissing off any German viewers. Yeah, hopefully you guys know this is all in good fun.
And the rest of you will be on the inside, attacking them in the funeral fog.
I think only I should be inside the fog, if possible.
Okay, so the rest of you will be outside.
Arrow's ready to go.
All right, so Gilbert will be outside as well. and Cornelius. So, a very brave Kytho will venture on up.
Hey, you cast that funeral fog and then walk up the steps, dude.
Yeah, I'm just traipsing around in this mortal realm because it's entertaining.
That's true. It is.
Yes.
All right.
Yes, I will cast the funeral fog before I go into the attic.
All right. All right, so all damage within the fog is multiplied by the caster's level. And but all damage is dealt randomly, or the targeting is dealt randomly. Okay. Well, let's roll initiative then. And I rolled a 5.
Hey, you want the 2d6 for the weather?
Oh. I got a 5. So it's I think it'll be partly sunny, cloudy. All right, so Kytho is just sort of like heading. We'll have you roll the initiative.
Oh, yep, I got a 3.
Oh, okay, yep. All right, yeah. So, you climb up there, and immediately because of the fog and the stench, it riles them up, and you see in the fog, in the shadows created by the fog. A pretty sizable swarm. There's 20 of them. So I am going to. It's going to take a bit. All right. Okay.
This is where Nice Maiden comes in handy. Slash roll 20 d20.
Yeah. Yep. Let me do that.
I think it'll take numbers into the hundreds now.
Baller. Can it do the DCC dice?
Yeah, it can do DCC dice.
It can probably do any arbitrary number of sides.
You can do a D13, D14, D15, don't matter.
Yep. Alright. I'm just rolling now to see if I get a 5% on my D100s here as I'm walking through this. Means it hits. Oh, hold on a second.
It's what, 21 of them, right?
Yeah. All right. What's your armor class? Oh, but yeah, minus 2 though. So, does a 13 hit you, Kytho?
13 does not. I'm armor class 14.
All right. Yeah, one of them dive bombs you.
Oops.
Okay. All right. Goodness, this spell is awesome, but incredibly annoying at the same time.
And there were 5.
Most awesome things usually are a bit annoying.
Okay. Oh, that's gonna be a miss. That's like a 1. Okay, yeah, so you get dive bombed twice, and 7. So 6, actually, because one of them was a... All right, yeah, 6 of them attack. So 6 of them drop. And they will now roll for morale, considering they just lost a third, and they're surrounded by this crazy stinking smog while this crazy-looking fey creature... I don't know. Enjoys the chaos that he's created. Oh, and look at that. They failed the morale check. All right, guys. Those of you who've been holding your action, well,
yeah.
You start seeing a swarm start coming out. You actually haven't held your action. It's now your turn. So,
the first one out of the cloud is going to get an arrow.
All right.
I think.
Go for it.
Well, I'm going to try and give him an arrow. I'm actually going to have to hit first.
Kaitho, if you want to try to take an attack, of course you can.
Sure, I'll take a swing at one.
Okay.
12?
Oh, I have to double check the AC. I think that's a miss, though.
I think so, too. Sorry, boss.
Yeah, and Funeral Fog, does the -2 affect the caster as well?
I'm going to say no. Because it's you're the one generating it. And, wow. That was a really... Yeah, armor class is a 14, so you need to roll a 14.
All right. For me, then.
Okay, we got a bunch of whiffs happening. It was a great plan, guys. Wonderful.
Well, they're still within sight and range at the moment, so I mean,
they ran, that's all that matters.
How do you do that reason thing again? I keep forgetting.
You put an exclamation point directly after the number, and then a space, and your reason.
Okay.
Colon works, too.
Oh, you said colon.
Oh, all right. Franz, you got one of them. Go ahead and roll damage.
Nice shot.
Try.
Okay. Well, you're able to wound it. And they are flittering out at max speed and disappear. I should say disappear, but they're heading into the forest surrounding the area.
Now is when we try to wall that thing up so they can't get back in.
Yeah.
Good thinking. We'll wall it up. At least until... Unless... Claytho's still in there.
It's true, he is. Alright, so you guys are going to take some time to take apart some of the... Well,
tables, benches, whatever.
Do you have nails and mallets and stuff? Like, what are you? How are you doing this?
I don't think I have any of that, but I do have a 17 strength. So if all else fails, I can just hammer it with my fist.
We got spikes,
tools in the wagons, like to repair wagons and stuff.
We could quickly run over and grab that. Yeah.
Oh, I got rope. I could tie knots.
Iron spike. We have small hammers and iron spikes. So we can use those and put a screen up, some rubbish, and another screen inside using the bedding. But if we can find some tarp in the stables, that would be better. Otherwise, we'll just use some of the heavy bedding.
If you may recall, the attic had a bunch of stuff that actually had tarps and whatnot draped over it. So... You'd be able to find that there.
Yeah, we could use those tarps.
All
right. You never know when you can use a good tarp. Are they blue? Are they them good Walmart blue tarps?
would this world even have Walmart?
That's just a joke, man.
Oh no. You know, I just freaking realized? The trading post run by those two chuckleheads probably has a blue roof.
Oh, yeah. Well, I wouldn't say this world has a Walmart, but the Nine Hells sure does.
That is fair. I'm just chuckling because now I'm imagining Grimog and... No, not Grimog, sorry. What are their names again?
Ranos, Davil, and Grimog.
Okay, it was Grimog. Grimog and Ravno as evil Walmart greeters now. Welcome! We should have exactly what you're looking for. Holy Grimog. Yes, Ravno. I'm in good spirits today, pardon me.
It's all good.
Those guys are tougher than what you would think, too.
Yeah. Damn right.
Those NPCs are one of the what I call happy accidents. I was not anticipating that they would be what they've become, and man, do I love it. Okay, so yeah, I'm gonna say it takes you maybe 30 minutes once you sort of figure out what you want to do, taking some of the stuff that's up in the attic, kind of pushing it towards the hole, using the spikes and the hammers to like basically put these tarps over the hole and the rubbish and all that stuff to kind of seal it up. A good windstorm will pull probably some of this up, and if they really wanted to get in there, they might be able to, but it's sealed up for now.
We can wait with the ranged weapons and aim for them as they fly back.
You probably won't come back till nighttime and try.
Probably not, no. Alright. Well, we took care of him for now. So do we want to tackle the dungeon next, or shall we sneak up on the bandits?
Let's make sure that nothing can get into the stables now. Make sure that it's tight, and then we'll go into the dungeon.
Alrighty.
The stables are pretty much enclosed, except you see these little squares here, their windows, they are broken. And they're all you'd really need to do is cover those up. And again, you could probably use the tarps.
Alright, we'll do that. I'm sure there's probably something in the stables we could use to pin them with.
Yeah.
Shoe horse tacks or something.
Yeah, yeah. You can easily find something like that. So, alright, so let's say after another 20-30 minutes, you have that taken care of. And now, guy's going to head into the dungeon. Yes?
Yep, now we're looking for the rest of the stuff.
Okay. Alright, well.
Alright, swapping back to melee then.
Alright. As you may recall, this, when you push the plaque on the statue, a door does open up, but it also releases like this gas, but you guys had disassembled the gas, and all you hear is some weird clicking and whirring sounds, and you know, nothing happens, obviously, and the door opens, and you can to a ladder that goes down into that room marked 1, and in that room, on the north wall is a small plaque that says, "Mark well your passage, you would-be robber. For the clever observe closely, and only the clever will win the day." And as you may recall, there was a secret little compartment on the left side there, the west wall. And inside was a lever. And then there's a door that opens up into that hallway. And at the end of that hallway is a door, and I don't think you guys made it to the door, but you did have the squirrel run around and nothing had happened. So there you have it. There's a lever I don't believe you've done anything with, and a hallway. So have
what can
at.
We what can we observe from the lever?
Real quick too. Who's got the light source, and what light source are you using?
Link boy would have the light source.
Okay. Is that a?
He's got a lantern.
Okay.
Yeah, I threw my lantern.
Okay. Oh, and so Gilbert, looking at the lever, the lever is finely crafted. You know, is well made, and it's just it appears to be in the down position. So it just pushes it up. And or down, and it's in the down position.
Say, Franz, can you tell if there's something wrong with this lever?
I'll inspect it and see if there's anything I can garner by just inspecting it closely. Is it a trap itself? Like, is it an idiot trap? You grab it, you pull it, you eat a face full of acid.
Oh, God.
What? You guys don't do that? I do all kinds of idiot traps to the funnest.
Yeah, you'd be surprised. You would be surprised. There's like this one thing that James Radji did where it's like this really intricate contraption which sends people to another planet to be eaten. Oh, never mind.
Yeah, yeah. Wait, yeah,
no. His last character went through that.
Oh, look in the telescope.
You don't see any nozzles or anything that's sticking out that would suggest gas trap, acid trap, or anything that was going to come out of the wall if the lever is pushed.
Yeah, so there's no shock. Yeah, there's no obvious thing that it does.
Yes.
But it could be one of those things where you got to do this to open the secret door five rooms down, but you don't know it till you can't find the secret door or something.
Do you think that we should raise it? Or was it already triggered?
I have no idea. I think it might be...
Oh, it's able to check for traps, and if there is one, we find a way to disarm it.
Just poke it with your stick.
I'd like to wait outside while you check.
Yeah, I'm actually in the stables. I don't know you guys. I don't know where anybody went.
If you seal yourselves in, I can push the plaque, right?
Sure, in the stables.
Okay. So
I don't know. The door to two is open. We got a hallway full of random shit, right?
No, no.
Like arrows? There's no arrow slits or weird stuff.
Let's see. Yeah, no, it's just, yeah, just a hallway, stone hallway. A little dusty. If you had the squirrel, Gilbert's squirrel ran down. And nothing happened. But you never really entered the hallway, other than the squirrel.
Yeah, this could turn off a big trap in the hallway, or it could turn one on. See, you know, just overthink it. So, it's either the turn-off valve, or it is the trap.
We got two ways to figure it out.
Yeah, we sure do. Goblin, I need you to go open up the door to two.
I'll go open the door.
All right. All right, as you approach the door, Gar, the Link Boy, I can't remember his name off the top of my head, shines the lantern down there so you can see, right? And you make it to the door without a problem. And there is a sign above it that says, Family Crypt, do not enter.
Okay, open the door.
Okay, make a saving throw versus poison as a little needle shoots out and sticks you in the hand.
I did not make it.
That is a fail. Roll a percentile dice, please.
He could roll his luck,
though. D100. He could. He could if he wanted.
Yeah, I'll do that, because I almost made that shit. I'll use my luck.
Okay. Can I tell you this guy's hand pricked on a doorknob down there?
I thought they should check for traps.
Well, I'm at the lever, so I'm thinking about maybe flipping the lever while he's down there.
Alright, so is that a pass? Well, guard just scrambled down there and opened the door and... Ow! Yeah, it's this little needle hits him. I take it a 13, yeah, that's gotta be a fail, right?
I got the halfling printout for the goblin and I got like an 8 for saving throw, for poison.
Really?
Nice.
Yeah.
Halflings are great savers, man.
Though they are, well, they are, when I made the character class, I did use the halfling as sort of a.
I think it's a 6 at level 2, so I made it.
Oh, all right, very good, very good. Lucky you, with that luck roll. Okay, yeah. So, Yeah, the needle comes out, pricks you, but you grab your finger and you actually squeeze out this weird blue inky stuff before it really gets inside you.
Ugh. I'll spit on the ground.
And,
Uh-oh.
It opens up into... Oh, come on, OBS. Let's not mess with me today. Okay. Opens up into a hallway. Are you well, you could enter the hallway. There's still some light from the lantern, but it's not gonna... It's actually gonna be pretty dark, so I better not reveal too much, so...
No, I'm gonna hang back like halfway through, wait for everybody to go, and go in near the end of the train of death.
Yeah, I'll go up ahead, and I will leave the switch in the down position. I so want to just push it up. Oh, hell with it. I go down there, and where he got checked, I see if there's a way if I can disable that so no one else accidentally grabs that thing and gets poked.
Okay. Make a... What would that be? Tinker roll. Tinker.
Got it.
Okay, yeah, you easily disable it. You actually remove the needle itself, and this little hose, like this little tiny hose made out of some kind of organic material, just sort of dribbles out all this like blue inky stuff. All right, so what is your marching order? We should probably get that down here. Gilbert, obviously, in the front, right?
Yes. Unless someone says otherwise, there's no reason why you shouldn't be out in front.
While we're doing that, I want to inspect that plaque that says Family Crypt.
Yep.
What's it made of?
What is plaques typically made out of? Some kind of marble?
Oh, marble or brass or, you know, depends.
We'll say marble.
Can I steal it?
You'd have to chisel away at the wall, but yeah, you could eventually take it.
You still got the tools?
Yeah, I got my tools. I mean, I'm going to make coffee tables out of all this dude's little warning things. I think it'd be funny.
Indeed. Yeah, if you want to spend some time chiseling away at it, you probably could do it with like a crowbar and a mallet or something.
Are you guys down for taking that, or we just do it later?
Yeah, you can take it.
On the way out if you want.
We'll do it on the way out. Oh, so when we take over the inn, we can make a sidewalk with, like, headstones and all these warning plaques.
Yeah. Yeah.
Because I'm a respectful archaeologist.
Well, I'm going to be in the back of the marching order with my short bow, firing into melee as usual.
If we're single file, it'll probably be Gilbert, then Hans, then the Link Boy, and then probably Thrones.
Yeah, I can't tap ahead with a pole arm if I'm that far back, though.
Well, then you could be behind Gilbert then, and if we go two abreast, you could be next to Gilbert.
Gilbert, you okay if we poking around you with the pole arm, tapping in front of you?
Yeah, just don't let the goblin make mean jokes about our butts.
All right. As you guys enter this intersection and shine the light to the north, there's a door. Another door at the end of the hall, and a door right in front of you. Oh, which way would you like to go?
Do these doors have markings on them?
These doors do not have markings on them.
Gilbert will take out his squirrel, put it out in front of him, and go, pick a door, little buddy.
But you do notice, as you're sort of like looking around, that the ceiling does have every so often holes in it. Roughly every foot or so.
We should get a table. We should go get a table from the inn and then put the table over top our heads and walk down the hall in case anything falls from the ceiling.
Yeah, good thinking. I've also got a shield. So the
shield wouldn't cover everybody, it would cover you. I'm thinking about getting something long that everybody could hide under.
Speaking of, which direction does my squirrel go off to?
Per what we discussed, it's a 2 in 6 chance of doing something that you want it to do.
Okay.
What exactly are you asked? Just give me some insight on where to go.
I am literally just taking out the squirrel and letting it go to whichever of the three directions it so chooses, or it can just stay put. And whichever one it goes to or susses out is the one that we shall go down.
Okay. Why don't you make that D6 roll? See what happens here.
Nailed it.
Okay. It scurries to the north.
All right. Gilbert will motion to the others to follow, and he'll very quietly, very calmly follow the squirrel, and as long as nothing jumps out and goes ooga booga or falls on our heads, he shall take the squirrel and put it back into his clothing.
Okay. All right. As you take the lead, why don't you do me a favor, roll a d10.
Right away. N.
Wow, interesting. Okay, yeah, as you sort of head north towards the door, all of a sudden this entire north section of this hallway just smells like cherries.
Uh-oh. Don't mean to scare you guys, but I think there's a gas leak.
And you have reached the door in relatively quick time.
Does the cherry smell affect the flame in the lantern at all?
No.
Okay. With the squirrel repocketed, Gilbert will move aside for Franz and motion, see if there's another trap.
Can we tell that the smell's coming like through them holes in the ceiling? Because maybe we do need to turn that thing off, man.
When you kind of like look up, Hans, and sniff, and maybe even get on your tiptoes, right, and try to get closer to the ceiling, it does seem like it's coming from the holes.
Yeah, let's go back and throw that switch. We'll go throw the switch, so we come back and see if that odor has stopped.
Okay. The odor has not stopped. But when you throw the switch, there is a deep rumbling that is heard. And, those of you who are in the hallway waiting for Franz to return hear a click, and this secret door down here kind of comes open a little bit. And, well, you see the wall shift, and apparently there's a secret door there.
Oh,
great job. We will listen at the secret door.
We'd have never known if we hadn't been standing down here.
Okay.
Show Franz where it was at.
Give me a second here. Just double checking. Yeah, you don't hear anything.
Right. We will very carefully, very slowly open the door.
Opens up into a hallway.
Excellent. I don't see any reason not to very carefully, very quietly tapping ahead, walk through the hallway.
We want to make sure this door will stay open.
Yes, do we still have spikes?
Did you purchase? Because you used a few for the roof repair.
I got a couple of arrows.
Actually, I have a dagger still. Would a dagger stuck in there keep it open?
I don't see why I wouldn't. If you'd like to use the dagger, you could.
All right. I will, or Gilbert will, looking around, seeing there's not enough spikes, we'll just get on one knee and just jam that dagger into the porthole. Should stay open.
Okay.
Maybe this is not the right time to ask or suggest or whatever, but would it be possible to upgrade your hardware? Because I'd actually heard from an old friend that OBS is actually pretty old.
Oh yeah, I know. It's been around for a while. I just haven't bothered to, or had the time to look into other, you know,
I see.
Platforms like that, or, you know, programs like this. Hmm. Okay, and coming down the hallway. You notice, again, more of the random holes up in the ceiling. And you come to a door. And next to the door on the north side, well, it would actually be to the, I believe, the right of you. Is a shelf carved into the wall. On the shelf is a small stone statue of one of the Borderlands, powers or superstitions. A stone statue of Saint MacGyver.
Franz, can you see if there's a little thing that's going to activate something on the roof if we take off the idol?
Yeah, I'll inspect the idol architecturally and for traps and see if there's a pressure release, like Indiana Jones style, if it goes off and there's a counterweight or whatever built into it.
Doesn't look
like it. Look for nozzles and all that, but I'm going to give it the full once over.
Okay. Yeah, after a good 10 minutes of just checking it out, you don't really seem to see anything. No pressure plate. I mean, there's nothing odd about the shelf it's resting at. Excuse me.
I whisper into the idol's ear, MacGruber.
MacGruber.
What's the custom for this particular type of idol, actually? Would that be a clerically type role, I guess?
Yeah, why don't you make like an intelligence check? See if you are familiar with the local superstition regarding this guy.
Ooh, I made it.
Yeah. Yeah, the Borderlands, you know, they worship all kinds of old powers and deities and creatures that they believe are gods, like the elves, for example. MacGyver is like a patron saint of sorts for those who wish to ward away thieves or those who I guess honor or believe in cunning and trickery. So sometimes he's venerated in that regard by those who are trying to steal stuff. Thieves, rogues, that sort of thing.
I'll stand there and try to recite a prayer to the to that particular god and then let him mess with the door.
Okay. Who's opening the door?
I'll open it.
All right. And opens up into another hallway. Again, lined with holes in the wall. Or, excuse me, ceiling.
Okay.
And you come to another door.
Does this still smell like cherries?
No. Nope. As you approach the door, you can hear on the opposite side violent growling.
Everyone, open the door. There's something on the other side.
What would you guys like to do?
I'm gonna slowly back up to door 8. Just have my bow ready.
Okay.
Sorin board's ready and my foot's ready to kick it in.
We'll check, make sure it's not got something on it.
Who's opening it? Am I gonna check it?
Yeah, I'll check it.
Okay. Why don't you make we'll say architecture roll. Okay. And yeah, so it doesn't appear trapped to you, but it is locked.
Oh, I'll pick that lock then.
Were able to unlock it with ease. And who is going in first?
Looks like it's me.
Yeah, I get back about 10 feet from him.
Okay. All right. Yeah, as the door opens and light shines into this room, there is a pit about 10 feet wide in the center of it. Along the edge of the pit is just an inordinate amount of paper and parchment just sort of strewn about and lining the pit. And the snarling is coming from the pit, and it gets louder, actually, as the light from the Link Boy's lantern kind of shines into the pit. The Link Boy's hands are shaky.
I grab him by the belt.
But he kisses his Arn symbol and utters a small prayer, and he looks resolved, ready to move forward. After the rest of you, of course.
I was about to tackle a kid again.
Hans will look at him and say, I was once where you are, my friend. I ran too.
So what would you guys like to do?
We step into the room, ready to swing.
Okay.
Can I aim at the pit? Or is that like an in-combat thing?
No, you can aim, like if you're kind of readying a weapon. Would you? Yeah.
I'm still kind of back by eight, but that's all I can see is a pit and body, so.
Yeah, I'll allow it. I mean, you're kind of like readying your weapon and you're going to shoot the first thing that sticks its head out, right?
Yeah, unless it's a beautiful lady.
Beautiful ladies are the most dangerous ladies.
I'll shoot a beautiful lady twice.
All right. So Gilbert boldly strides forward. Anybody following him?
Yeah, I'll join.
Okay.
And, we get the lantern right up to the doorway. What do we see in the pit?
Inside the pit, it's about 15 feet deep.
Okay.
And inside is a large, thin, thin, wiry, green-skinned, with this ridiculously long and twisted nose, missing teeth, but like super sharp. It's naked, leathery skin, snarling, and it's trying to jump, but it can't reach the. Can't reach the lip.
You got a photo for that, Len?
I don't, unfortunately. But
otherwise, Gar, start sniping that thing.
Oh, fish in a barrel?
Yeah. And already in action, sword lifted in case it can jump really high. I'm going to take a swing at it if it tries to jump.
Okay. Yeah, the, you also see sort of in the pit along the sides are small holes every so often, very similar to the ones up in the ceiling of the hallway. All right, so Gar, you're going to take a shot at it. You're going to walk up and shoot it.
I'll walk up and inspect it.
Okay. I don't want to say.
I got the description.
Yeah. It will. Why don't we have Kaitho and Gar just make a quick language roll for me?
Is that a D6?
Yes, it is. You'll have a 1 in 6 chance plus any intelligence bonus added into that.
Would I be able to roll 2D6 and if I get snake eyes, I get it?
That would, but I'm yes, but I'm doing. These guys would actually have a better. Would actually be familiar with this, so I'm giving them the first shot.
These rolls always mess me up. I have a minus two, so I got a 7.
Oh, okay.
That's why I asked the 2d6 because I think if it brings it lower to 1, you got to roll snake eyes.
Yeah, that's pretty much how that works. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. It's definitely speaking some kind of language. Magical in nature, but you have no idea what it's saying. The rest of you probably would not have any chance in hell in actually understanding this.
Well, since it's magic in nature, could I do a spellcraft?
Yeah, why don't you make a spellcraft roll? You wouldn't know the language, but you might be able to identify this creature, considering that is like your...
Ooh, missed it.
Bread and butter as an inquisitor.
Luck still.
As far as you're concerned, this is some kind of demon trapped in a well.
Yeah. If it can't get out, why don't we just leave it?
I think we should leave it. I like his eyes.
All right, we'll leave it for now.
Oh, yeah, the eyes are like black, bulbous, pupilless. It's just jet black. And it's just snarling and screaming at you all.
I throw a ration and an extra pair of pants down.
Okay. It stops screaming, gobbles up the rations, and kind of glances at the pants. It's not 100% sure what to do with them. But then it does look up at you.
I make the motions that you put your pants on, point at the pants, and then flip in the bird, and then walk away.
I like it.
Maybe. Yeah.
The creature. Actually, gnawing on the pants.
Eat my shorts, man.
Oh, it is eating your shorts.
I think I will do what he always told me to, Bart, and start by eating your shorts.
Okay. So we got two hallways and a door. Is that what we got?
Yep. And there's this parchment that's strewn about.
Let's look through those and see what they say.
Okay. I go inspect the other door for traps since it's a door right there in front of me.
Okay. Go ahead and make a search roll for me. And Hans, you can make a spellcraft roll as you're looking at this pieces of paper. It's definitely magical. And Franz, it does not appear to be trapped.
I can't make out what these papers are, but they seem to be magic. Some kind of magical writing.
Are they surrounding this little well?
Yeah.
Like obviously a circle of some kind?
No. But they're just kind of strewn about.
Okay.
And some of them actually, as you're sort of like picking up the pieces of paper, it looks like there might actually be dried feces on them. Kind of smudging the and obscuring some of the writings and strange glyphs and formula that are written all over the pieces of paper.
Was this thing using it to magic user spell book to wipe its butt and throwing it out of the hole?
Maybe it was a miscast. Would we be able to clean up the shit and get the spell?
I'm okay with taking whatever you think is magical. Or all of it, whatever. I'll help out. Stuff them in my backpack.
Alright, so
okay,
you're...
with his offhand, Gilbert's gonna take the non-crud covered page, and he's not gonna set it on fire, but he's going to put it near the lantern to see if he can see if the ink shines through.
Like, shine through the crud?
Kind of. Like, you know how if you put a flashlight up to a piece of paper, or you light flashlight through a piece of paper, it'll show something?
Oh, I
see. Or you'll be able to see, like, the contours of the paper? I want to see if we'd be able to get the letters from there. And I'm going to be taking great care not to set this on fire accidentally.
Sure. So
I need to describe this nice so it doesn't sound like I'm a complete idiot.
No, I get it. I see what you're doing. No, you're not seeing any, like, hidden writing. You're just seeing a lot of numbers, strange glyphs, strange designs and drawings, words that sound, you know, if you tried to sound them out, it'd be gobbledygook, you know?
Alright, well, we'll find a place for the shit-covered paper.
I stuff it all in my backpack, I don't care.
Okay. So, which direction will it be, guys? Go through the door?
Go to the How far left. Do those halls go? I'll take me and Link, we'll go over to each of those hallways and shine the lantern down them.
Sure.
Hey, there's another pit in this other room, and the other room.
Lots of pits. I wonder...
Three pits and three doors. So I'm guessing one of these is the right one, and two of them is the you just got screwed ones. I want to see that. I'm gonna try to go like put the Link Boy right in the middle of the rooms, and I'm gonna like lean in there and see if we can. Is there the same thing in the other pit?
Which one do you want to check out first, 11 or 12?
11, I guess.
Okay. So you and the Link Boy head into 11, and again you have a 10-foot wide, 15-foot pit. And as you kind of peer into it, it looks like it's filled with I guess like this glistening thick black liquid, like maybe oil. It's not filled to the lip. I mean, it's pretty far down there, like maybe 10-ish feet. Yeah, like maybe 5 feet down, you sort of see like this what appears to be something like oil just sort of sitting there. And the sides of the pit appear to be made of polished crystal. And but it is damaged.
Like, I will report that back to everybody and then go look at pit 12.
Okay, again, 10 foot wide. In the bottom, you see a mass of paper. And inside are three emaciated, hungry-looking undead. And as they see you, they start snarling and jumping to try to, you know, get at you. But, you know, they're too far down. They're ghouls, just like you saw in the moat house.
All right, report that back to the party. There's three ghouls in the other one. And oil in the other.
What kind of damage was on the crystal walls on the number 11 pit?
That's what I was thinking. Was it like scratches or was it crack?
But there's some cracks that are like near the lip. They don't go down, just like sort of like the top has been the top part of the walls have been damaged ever so slightly. But it's not like the cracks go down into the pit or anything like that.
It's like something heavy was shoved over the lip or something.
You could conclude that, maybe. Maybe something dropped on the lip.
What's above the pits?
Ah, just stone ceiling. These ceilings do not have the holes in them. You know, inspecting the crystal, you think the crystal could be valuable if broken and carted off.
Oh. Is it crystal over pit 12 too?
No, pit 12 is just like pit 10, except there aren't any little holes for rodents or whatever to make its way through.
Yeah. All right, well.
The creature in pit 10 is resumed screaming at you. And at some point, some feces will be hurled out of it.
That little bastard.
That's disgusting.
So we got three doors here. Three ghouls. And a demon creature that throws shit.
Let's go to room 11 and check that door.
I think it's the safest one. We took a secret door here.
Okay. Gonna check the door 11.
Somebody is.
Yeah, I'll check it.
Go ahead, make your, do a cert. No, architecture. Architecture.
You gotta be kidding me. Just like three of those in a row.
It is the safest door you've ever seen. But it is not locked.
Would, if he's not sure of it.
Can I check your, I got a feeling. It just screams. Everything gets slid into the damn pit.
If you don't mind me asking, would out of curiosity, would Gilbert be able to give it a shot?
What? Check for traps?
Architecture.
Yeah, you can always do that, yeah. You got a 1 in 6 chance.
Oh, I know, but it's still worth a try. I don't know, man. Yeah, maybe it is safe.
Actually, I check the floor and see if the floor tilts, not just the door, because it just screams that the whole floor tilts and we all get shoved in the pit.
Right.
So instead of checking the door, which would be the trigger, I see if I can find a mechanical sign that the floor pivots or a shifting room type thing.
I gotta ask, have you memorized Grimtooth's traps?
No.
He probably has.
No,
You're a veteran. You're a veteran. Yeah. No, you don't see anything that looks like the floor pivots or anything. In fact, if you take a little bit of water from your water skin and kind of like dribble it on the floor, it just pools. It doesn't start rolling towards the pit at all.
All right, I was just curious because the pits are in the middle of the room. The rooms are separated by a space, and in the center of the south wall is a door. So it does look like one of those, it's just shut everybody down the hole, like one of those little trap, those little games where you put quarters in, they get to push the corners off of.
Right.
I'm a big fan of putting the 5-foot wide pit in the hall that's open. And on the other side is the actual pit trap. So when I jump the 5-foot pit, you go down the pit.
Oh yeah, I seen that one. Slanting floor, you jump across and slide to your death.
Yeah.
All right, Gilbert, do your magic, buddy.
Magic?
That door needs open.
Yeah. And Gilbert will open up the door.
Alright. And it opens up into a hallway. And as the lantern light shines onto the hallway and the ceiling, those holes, those random holes, appear again.
Yeah, part of me's wondering if something's gonna trickle out of those holes and punish anyone who's nice and deep in the dungeon. Let's see here. We continue downward.
Okay.
What the hell?
All right. As you round the corner, lantern falls onto the lantern light falls onto the door marked 13. And you see another one of those plaques above the door. And it says, "Do not enter. Private chapel."
It makes me want to put plaques up and say, "Go no further. Dungeon under construction."
Well, check for traps.
I'll inspect the door.
Okay, go ahead. It does have an obvious lock, but it is not locked. You do note, looks like you succeeded there. You do note two things. One, there is some sort of mechanism attached to this door that, if it is open, counterweights, it appears, built into the walls, will drop and trigger something. But there's also a way to bypass this by actually using a key.
Could I pick it and bypass it by picking the lock, or do I need an actual tumbler set for the key?
You need the actual thing, because the door itself is not locked, but like that locking mechanism will unlock the or keep the trap from springing. So like you could open the door, is what I'm trying to say. It's not locked, it's not stuck, you can open it, but opening it will trigger something. But
can you disable it?
Yeah, that's what I was asking. Can I pick the lock to disable it, or can I get into it and keep the counterweights from moving?
You can certainly try.
I try to disable it.
Make your tinker check.
Tinker. Made it by two.
Nice.
Very nice. Dang. That was going to be challenging. Okay, yeah, you're able to keep the counterweights from dropping, and you seem confident that you have succeeded. Who is opening the door?
If the trap is disarmed, then that would be Gilbert.
Yo, let's stand back, away from the trap now.
All right.
Wait, didn't we undo the trap, or what's going on?
The door opens, and you hear, like, some grinding sounds, almost like gears, grinding gears, that are stuck. And you just kind of hear this, like, echoey, like, clicking noise, as if these gears are just kind of stuck and can't accomplish whatever turn, a task they're meant to fulfill. And it persists as it sort of echoes around you. And your lantern light shines upon a shrine. In the center of the south wall is a large brass statue of Saint MacGyver, surrounded by burnt-out candles. The room is carpeted, though faded, and there are many prayer pillows strewn about the place. Some of them are torn open with stuffing all over the floor. In the center of the room is a decapitated skeleton. Not a shred of flesh on it, of a small, misshapen man. The figure is clad in leather armor, though it's not nearly as decayed. It's still functional, I guess, is the best way to put it. And a backpack with a sword fallen at this skeleton's side.
Where is the skeleton in relation to the statue?
I see this little, like, black smudge stuff in front of the star. That's where it is.
I'll kind of go around the perimeter of the room and see if I can see behind the statue. I'll start out on the side where the number 14 is.
Okay.
Looks like someone got roasted, huh?
Well, we're going to avoid directly in front of there, but we will pull aside the dead guy and look through his stuff.
Okay.
Bill Gearson and pull his body back from a distance.
Kytho, as your elven eyes don't catch anything out of the ordinary. This is just a standard chapel of sorts dedicated to this alleged power of the Borderlands, dedicated to trickery and trap making and roguish exploits, but nothing jumps out at you.
That's both good and bad. Nice not to get decapitated by something coming out of the wall.
What's on the stiff?
Oh, I'm sorry. Yeah, opening up the backpack. Like I said, the backpack is still somewhat functional, so you guys do have a backpack now. There's a suit of leather armor that's still somewhat functional. Just looks like shit, to put it bluntly. I mean, it's old. And there's a short sword that is still functional. Just needs to be cleaned up. And inside the backpack is this. A map.
Oh.
Here is the map I promised you. I expect payment to be arranged. Grant? The true tomb here. Minor personal effects of unholy. Please do not disturb. The real treasure is near the false tomb. Complicated trap rooms bring in an experienced thief. Other builds myself ignored the diabolical, so I'm told. False tomb, do not be fooled. No treasure. Ah, thank you very much. Secret treasure here, not with the body. Star room, don't look at the walls. Magical hypnosis trap. I'm not sure if Gilbert could even read any of that, but he's going to hand it to someone who did and look to the corpse and say, thank you.
The corpse sits up and says, you're welcome. Just kidding, it doesn't do that.
Nope, too late, it did.
It's canon. It's canon.
Yep. Oh, that was odd. Oh well, onto the treasure.
He's already lost his head. My axe will be useless.
Alright. So you guys have found a map to something.
I see some stairs on that map. So to get down to the fake tomb, we need to find the stairs. I think underneath the statue, there might be some stairs. Check. And can I see what set this guy on fire? Was it a trap from the statue?
All right. Why don't you make a architecture roll, and I'm going to give you you know what, you don't even need to make a roll. There's the statue is essentially embedded in the floor. It doesn't move, and you don't see anything, you know, and that leads you to conclude there's, you know, if there was some sort of fire mechanism trap or whatever, it would need to be some sort of compartment, right, to refuel it, and you're not finding anything. It's a pretty solid statue.
Any burn marks in the ceiling?
Nope.
But there's holes?
Not in this room, no.
Okay. Let's use the torchlight. Let's search all this room then. the walls and everything. Start searching. Yeah. Let the tomb robber there take a look at the rest of it too, I guess, the statue or whatever.
Yeah, see if there's a secret compartment in the bum.
Okay.
That's what I'm gonna do. I'm gonna make a big statue and I'm gonna put a secret compartment in the bum. So only perverts find my treasure.
Careful, a lot of adventurers are perverts, and you're gonna be reenacting that one South Park episode.
After you guys spend a good 15 minutes here, we'll say 15-20 minutes, there is nothing in this room other than what I've described.
The torn up pillows and stuff, does that look like signs of a fight?
Or just rodents?
Yes.
Oh, yes, it's rodents, or yes, it was a fight?
Oh, sorry. Yes, there. It's signs of a fight.
Oh, okay.
Do you need to take a coffee break there, champ?
Well, I was, like, in the middle of, like, thinking about how to respond to his, and then...
I see.
Guard decided to interject. I blame him.
Yes, okay. I am making the shame hand gesture at his icon on Discord.
Shame.
Yeah, you definitely don't want to make this hand gesture in a Greek bar.
Well, we took a secret tunnel here to the chapel. We've got three pits. And I think we've checked everything out.
Did we look under the rugs?
If you spend some time looking under the rugs, you find nothing.
All right.
Well, I don't see nothing here. Let's just backtrack.
Are the rugs valuable?
Are the rugs valuable? I am going to say yes to the right buyer. Rolling them up and carrying them out can be done. But I'm going to say that they will be they're not just oversized items. They'd be like carrying two oversized items, so like two encumbrance points. That could be divided between two individuals as you sort of like, you know, two people carry the rugs on each shoulder, you know what I'm saying? Go ahead.
Sorry, we'll get this and the marble thing on the way back.
Okay. We're going to decorate our house with plundered items.
Yar, like a pirate.
Should we pack it up to, like, hallway 8 or something and then leave it there?
Yeah. Or as long as it's away from the poop thrower.
Dodge him.
Carpet.
Hey, are the rugs large enough to stretch over the top of the pits?
I would say so.
We could Pavlov. We're showing to cat that thing, man. Goes just put it on the top and go, you behave, you don't get no light. I've managed to hold back on the lotion in the basket.
I was just about to say something.
We gotta just pee on the fucking demon.
If we need a bathroom break soon, then we can use it as a cliffhanger. I'm not sure it's wise, though.
Speaking of which, why don't we do take our 5 minute, and we'll keep going for another hour, if that's okay.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah, you can make a reaction roll and see if it likes it, which would be even creepier.
You said it. Now it's gonna happen.
It's canon.
Yep.
I got some rope. We can just throw the rope down. Have a pet.
Oh, we're going to get really kinky if we're doing urine and rope.
Okay. All right. If I was monetized, I'm not anymore. Okay.
Sorry. Oh, wait. You can swear again now.
Well, they reinforced that behavior. Now, if we were saying that was bad behavior, we would be demonetized. But since we're saying, hey, right. But you know what? We'll throw a dress down for the creature, and we'll make it all right.
Yeah, there's no king shaming here. We don't king shame anyone.
Oh, I absolutely do. Freaking degenerates.
even in Lamentations?
Yeah.
All right.
By playing it, I am making fun of it.
Whatever you say, bud. Whatever you say. See you guys in 5.
Yep.
Much better.
We should take that crystal before we move off from here.
What are you talking about? What crystal? Is there a crystal?
There's a crystal lip around the edge of the oil pit.
Yeah, it's around the lip. I think that's keeping the oil. I don't think it's oil, dude. I'm thinking that's a gobbledygook monster.
The crystal goes all the way down. So it's like all the walls are lined with it. It's just near the lip. The lip is where it's broken.
It still screams gobbledygook monster.
I love this credits to wait screen with the Honor of the Fallen.
Yeah, I decided to add that after the TPK. Thank you.
Yeah, TPKs are part of my dungeon design. You put one right by the front door, and you put one in the dungeon somewhere. Two TPKs should be built into every module.
Badass.
You make the first one obvious. You make the first one obvious. Make an idiot trap. And if they kill themselves on the idiot trap, that's on them. And I don't like doing more than one every eight rooms or a trap. One every eight. But I do like a lot of tricks.
Yeah, that's actually a similar philosophy is behind that very first encounter in Tower of the Stargazer when you're opening the door. Like, the door handle looks like a snake, and if you don't knock, the snake bites you and kills you, you know? And the idea is to kind of set the tone. You're entering a wizard's tower. It's going to be defended. You know?
Yep.
So.
Yeah, or make it an easily avoidable critter. You know, I haven't made one of my own modules in a long time. I usually just take something that's pre-made and pervert it, usually. Twist it.
Yeah.
But I like seeing my design philosophy in a dungeon. I don't have to do too much tinkering to make it just like how I would do it.
Tower of the Stargazer is really nice because it's written with newbie game masters, referees in mind. So there's a lot of Raji's notes in the sidebar. His commentary on the telescope is it's like, it may sound harsh to have the players be eaten, but consider how much work they put into getting to this point. And it's like goes into that psychological player psychology he gets into with a lot of his stuff, where he just knows players are going to want to push the big red button.
He also mentioned on the note of the sneak handle, it's like, he actually says, you know, look, this seems harsh for the first door. It's like, look, guys, why didn't you wear a metal glove while you were doing that? Why didn't you have the door for the halfling do it? Why didn't you get a hireling to do it? You know, why did you just strut up a suit like you own the place and assume you could just walk in and wouldn't face potential dangers?
Yeah.
And it's a great point. It's a great point.
All right, I think we're all back, so let's get back to the campaign. All right.
Franz. Sorry, I was going to tell Franz that black stuff's like 5 feet from the bottom, from the top. Do you want to try to see if we can see what it is? We could dip some rope down, maybe just get with the end of it.
Sure, you go ahead and do that. I just rewatched The Blob last week, so I don't know.
I'll stand a few feet from the hole and toss the end of a rope down into the pit with the black stuff and try to get the tip.
Just the tip? Yeah.
Let's wait for that one, too. Okay.
That's the whole point. You wait for it. It's anticipation.
Okay. Let's see. Okay. And you're a few feet away from the pit?
Yeah. I'm not holding on to the, like, you know, I'm just tossing in enough that I know it should hit the liquid and then pull it back up.
Okay. You toss. Is this like 50 feet of rope? You coiled, right? And you just kind of...
Yeah.
All right. All of a sudden, the rope just starts being pulled into the pit.
Let it go.
And it's just, you know, just... zips along and then just you see your rope disappear into it.
And I say, do not touch that shit again.
All right.
Now, here's what we do. We get 2 50-foot sections of rope. We lasso the monster in the bottom pit and then throw the other part of the rope in that hole over there.
That sounds like a great plan.
Yeah, what could go wrong? We'll see if he's strong enough to pull that thing out of that up to us. Or if he would just get truly, like, keel hauled across the floor into the pit. That'd be fun to watch, at least.
Anyways, did we grab the rugs?
Yeah, we grabbed the rugs. We'll take a little bit of time, and we'll
roll them up, yeah, so we can get them on the way back.
Okay, and you're just going to leave them in room 14, or are you going to drag them to some other location in the dungeon?
I think we got to go to 8, or that secret door that opened up or something, leave them there.
Let's haul him to the room.
Yeah, that's a secret. Yeah, let's just take him back to the main entrance. Stack him up by the thingy, Bob.
Okay.
Ladder.
All right.
You know, for a future thing for dungeon delving, we might want to do that. Leave like extra bags and like stuff to be carried, like empty crates to be nailed and took out when we get ready to leave. Just pack things up properly.
It's actually not a bad idea. GM, I'm just going to drop a couple bags here at the entrance of the dungeon here. And then the other bags you got are filled. You're like, I'm going to go back to the dungeon, beginning of the dungeon, leave the filled bags there, grab the empty, head back in.
Yeah, I used to do stuff like that with my mage when I played in 2E and 1E, and I'd leave backpacks with like explosive rune scrolls sticking out of them.
Nice.
Symbol of death.
All right. Well, we are back in the hallway here at the intersection. You're staring at a door. Right, you're at the door right in front of 2, and you're staring at a door in front of you. You got the door to room 7, and then the door to the left that the squirrel originally had headed up towards. Where would you like to go now?
We gone.
I like the squirrel's plan.
I like the squirrel's plan too. Okay. We're at number 6, number 2, number...
Number 2.
Number 2. Okay. Gilbert will let loose the squirrel again and see what direction it chooses to go. Unless it just decides to just lie there. It decides to just lie there.
Yep. It just looks at you. It's nibbling on an acorn or something.
Yeah. Yeah, Gilbert probably picked up like a couple acorns on the way and like uses this to like feed the little guy. Well, he's gonna put the squirrel back. I think we should go down southward.
Past the secret door. Down to 7.
Yes, we will search on the left and right face of each. Actually, hold. Didn't we get through here through a secret door? Yeah, we did. We will start making our way down to number 7.
Okay. All right. You are at the door. What would you like to do? You can open.
Friends, you know what to do.
I check the door.
Upon cursory glance, you're not noticing anything out of the ordinary. Why don't you make an architecture roll? Safe as can be. Pretty confident.
It's all right. Is it locked?
It is not locked.
All right, Gilbert, we'll give that an open.
All right. This room painted as if it was the night sky, dark and full of stars.
Oh, we close the door and close our eyes. Hold on. The map told us not to do that.
That was behind a secret door.
No, it's not. It, on this map, it says star room. Don't look at the walls. Magical hypnosis. But it's like off a hallway. And it's not a hallway that it looks like what we're in. So is this the room to the north or to the south, 7?
I don't know. It also looks like it's 5x3 and not 2x6, but...
There could be multiple instances of the same kind of trap.
Everybody, okay, here's what we should do.
Put a rope around the goblin, send him in, and if he gets mesmerized, yank him out. Gotcha.
I'm down.
I mean, we'll cover our eyes, and we'll feel around the room and see if there's a way out.
Send the chaos monkey in. He's down for it.
Yeah.
Okay.
I'll grab my own rope and tie it around my waist.
Okay.
We start talking about knot work and getting all nice and knotted up. Stupido.
All right, Gar. You boldly stride forward. And yes, this is painted as if it was the night sky, dark and full of stars. In the center of the ceiling is the moon, large and shining. It's actually glowing in the dark.
Wow.
And, yeah. That's pretty much it.
Are there any, like, constellations I can make out? Anything on these walls?
Why don't you make a intelligence check?
Oh, God. yes. Barely.
The while it looks authentic, like, you know, it might be, you know, the spring sky, you know, at a particular time in the borderlands, it's not. It's like someone just randomly was making a star chart or something. So it's
like a kid's room.
Yeah, they're just taking their little stickers, putting them all over the place. But you do notice something. There seems to be odd details in the moon, but they're too small to see. If only there was something to magnify it.
Oh. I need to go steal a lantern, I think, and charge up my stickers.
Too bad we still don't have that egg.
Indeed.
I'll go to the link boy and grab a lantern.
Okay.
Head back into 7.
Alright. What are you doing with the lantern?
Just shining it around the walls.
Okay.
Up towards the moon. I'm like 3 feet tall, so I don't know if I get any closer.
Again, the moon appears to have some odd details about it, but they're really hard to see. You need something to magnify them.
With the 5 intelligence.
Would I have a magnifying glass as part of my thieves' tools, or would that be something I would have to add on to it? Because I've been wanting to add an awl, a bone saw, steel saw, and something like a magnifying glass. I just haven't done it.
Well, a magnifying glass is...
It's like a jeweler's kit or something?
Not... You know, that's actually a really good question, because specialist tools are just that. I mean, it's like this broad category. And the specialist character class can kind of design what you're specialized in. Broadly speaking, you don't necessarily have to be a thief. So, would you have a magnifying glass? You know what?
And I'm like a tomb robber too. I do speak languages, so
I will allow it. But this is what I'm going to do. I'm going to have you use a search check if you want to use it.
Sure. Since he hasn't exploded, I'll go in there and check it out. I mean, since it looks pretty cool,
he hasn't exploded yet. Okay. All right, go ahead, make your search roll as you look at the moon.
Six.
Oh yeah. Your magnifying glass is I guess maybe not powerful enough, but there's definitely something there.
I will probably make a list of oddball stuff I've been wanting to do for a while. I was afraid to do it because honestly, I think if I invest in that kind of detail, I'm good as dead. I got jinxed myself and die.
It does happen.
Yeah, I get it.
Maybe let the goblin use the thing and see if he can try and see what's in there.
Yeah, I hand him the magnifying glass and then tell him I want it right back when he's done.
Can I jump on your shoulders?
Who's taller? you need a tall. If you want to jump on someone's shoulders, you go on the tall person's shoulders. Who's the tallest character?
Jump on the goblin's shoulders. He'd like it that way.
I put him on my shoulders then, and I glare at the other guy who's obviously taller than me.
All right, make your search roll.
Check it out. Yep, it's a moon.
Yeah, there's something there. It's just you need something more powerful. Like at first glance, it's like, was this just a smudge that like they make a mistake when they painted it? But there's like an obvious pattern. There's something about it, but you need to magnify it.
Now get on the goblin shoulders and try.
I roll a 2 for spellcraft.
Aside from the obvious heresy of this place, you know, to Saint MacGyver and all this strangeness, there's nothing magical that you're picking up here. There's no ritual, you know, it's not like there's some sort of weird astrological thing going on here. Again, because these are just randomly placed stars, they're not actually the sky.
All right, we've waited here long enough. Gilbert's just going to give up and go in with a squirrel and lift a little squirrel up to the moon and see what happens. See if you know anything about this. Although, Gilbert might get a chance too because he's frickin' tall.
The squirrel goes into a rendition of Somewhere Out There from American Tale.
I was waiting for him to pull a cane and a top hat out and go, "Hello, my honey, hello, my baby."
Can I roll a bushcraft to kind of like interrupt the song and see if it actually does its job?
Go ahead.
Nowhere close. It's decided to sing, and once it's done with that, it's going to go for "Don't Cry From Argentina." Maybe you're like a fairy squirrel. And Gilbert's just going to actually, what would Gilbert be able to take a look as well?
Yes, I will allow it.
All right.
You have a 1 in 6 chance. Nope.
And I rolled a 3. Gilbert's just gonna leave. He's like, huh? But it's still singing. I wonder if you're a fairy.
Nope. All right. Let's move north.
Okay. All right, so are you going to go to the door up here or this door in the center?
center.
Okay. Oh, well, look at that. I accidentally revealed the secret door. That's it. That's okay.
That's okay. I see one right there that I see. I'm like...
Oh, yeah, there we saw one.
I know that thing opens the moon. We know it's there, but we don't know it. I didn't see no reason to search that wall, though, so...
Here, I'll just do this. You've seen it. It is what it is. Okay, give me a second here.
As we're pulling down that corridor, do we notice anything different? Because if not, we'd probably just keep on going.
What you see is, the same holes periodically. Oh, speaking of which, why don't you roll a d10 there, Hans?
Oh, here they come.
I'm on 10. We want cherry. Oh, not cherries.
Ooh. All right. Roll 1d6.
Oh. Six.
And roll a 1d6.
One.
Oh, God. Okay.
And we're surprised, right?
Yep. All right. So you guys are moving down the corridor towards door number 4. And give me a second. And dropping from the ceiling are 6 giant, very large. They're probably about 2 to 3 feet long, squeezing their way through these holes. Giant ants. They're red-shaped, or red in color, excuse me. And they just drop down amongst on top of you guys. So,
peace. Ants.
So they are going to get an attack on all of you. So we'll start with Gilbert. A 16. What's your?
He just misses.
Okay. Yeah, like kind of bounces off your shield and it's like crawling all over you right now. All right, Hans. That will be an 11. I'm pretty sure that does not miss or it does not
AC
hit.
AC 20.
Okay, Franz. Ooh, 21.
Oh yeah, that's definitely a hit.
Take 2 points of damage. This thing like drops down on your back and bites its pincers, get into your neck there. Already did Gilbert. Kytho, that's a 9. Gar, ooh, 17.
Yes.
All right, Gar, yeah, same. You got this giant ant biting into you, and then Cornelius, that's going to be a miss, and I know he had to actually leave, so I'll just be kind of running his character for the time being. Alright, so let's roll initiative. You got 6 giant fire ants on you. I rolled a 2. Basically, everyone's got one on them. Hans, oh, Tanner got it. Okay, you guys are going first.
Yeah, I'm just going to jam my sword in the fire ant that just tried to nip me.
Okay. Go ahead.
Alright.
Roll initiative.
Tanner got it.
Here
we go.
Oh,
1-T-0. No. Oh, I missed that. Okay, alright. Hold on, I'm going to use that Lucerne hammer and try and knock that one off of Franz's back.
Sweet 16, is that hit?
Actually, it does not. The carapace of this thing is quite tough.
Everyone run!
So their AC is higher than 16?
Yes.
I get an extra +1 to hit.
Okay. at Hans. You swing and a miss.
I'll swing at the one on me.
Okay.
Unless Claytha was a spell that can cut through these things, we'd better hustle.
Yeah, my funeral fog wouldn't be very effective here. I don't think there's that many of them, and we're all mixed in together.
Does a 22 hit?
It does hit.
It does not.
Dang it.
Oh, come on.
Yeah, I can't really attack the one on me, so I kind of shake it, and I thrust at whatever's in front of me with the pole arm at reach.
All right, Gar, you, your weapon sinks into it. All this goo pours out of its abdomen. It's still alive, and it's screeching and screaming, but it's still alive. Hans, your Bilbisarm does not find purchase. Sad to say. And Cornelius will also miss as he swings at it with, I think he's carrying a dagger. Okay. Their turn.
We should concentrate attacks.
Yep.
I got a 15, but I got a 16 actually with the plus one for being an adventurer.
All right, yeah, that again, your blade, as you like, sort of like throw this thing off you and then you swing at it, your blade almost seems to bounce off its carapace. Like it's pretty solid and tough to break through. All right, so.
Oh, even with a 16?
Yep.
Nasty.
All right, boys, it's all time.
Okay. And I rolled terribly for all six of them as they like nip at your, you know, you've guys shaken them off. They're down on the ground. Your guys are sort of like, it's a chaotic melee in the middle of this hallway, as any semblance of marching order is just gone. The things are just nipping at your ankles and or jumping up at your abdomens, they're not able to find any kind of purchase. So let's roll initiative. I got a 3. Hans, why don't you do it?
You're welcome.
All right, the giant fire ants press the attack. Ooh. Franz, that's a 19. Oh, that's 6 points of damage. This thing leaps up and sinks its mandibles into your gut. Gilbert, that's a 19.
Luck check. He's got to do it over again.
Okay. All right. All right. As it leaps up into your face, you know, you go to like sort of like parry or bash it away. But as you sort of step back and lean, you slip on some of the goo that squirted out of Gar's ant, and you like kind of like almost fall, and the thing misses you because of that. All right, Kaitho. Oh, Kaitho, that's a 19. Take 4 points of damage as the thing sinks into your thigh, appears dangerously close to your, what artery is that?
Femoral,
yeah. Gar, 15? That hit you, Gar?
Nope.
Okay. And then a 15. All right. And Cornelius takes 2 points of damage. All right. Your turn, guys.
Hey, was that Hans or Franz that got hit this round?
Oh, Franz.
Franz.
Yeah.
I think another 6. Okay.
Yeah, it's like
next round. I'm gonna heal you, man.
All right.
I'm also thinking that we should start running as fast as we can.
You know, I got like 11 more hit points, right?
I got 2 hit points.
I've got 15. You have 2 hit points.
Listen. Everybody needs to make a break for that door and get through that door, and we need to try to get some oil on the floor.
Yes, we're gonna retreat. Fighting retreat back through the door, and we're gonna get a vial of oil ready.
But this round, we didn't say that, so this round, I'll be finishing my swing of my looser arrow.
Alright. Gilbert, being Gilbert, since he sometimes just does stuff without telling people, is going to start his fighting retreat as he takes a swing at the ant.
Okay, go for it.
Yeah, I'll backpedal and start pokey-pokey.
Okay.
Yeah, I'll try to move with the group. And that's why I didn't hit.
Okay.
Space Sense, that's a miss.
Yeah, I'll start retreating. I'm also going to go into defensive combat. Can elves use the defensive combat option?
Yes, they can. Yes, they can.
Okay, cool.
So you'll be a -4 to attack, but you get a +2 to your armor class. That is a hit, Franz. All right, Franz, you splatter one. And it creates a puddle of goo. Kaitho, that is literally a whiff. Gilbert, you did actually like strike it. You find purchase, but again, the carapace, just your weapon just slides off of it. And Gar, that is another hit. You don't even need to bother rolling. You kill the one that...
Yeah.
Will swing and a miss. I think that's everybody, right? Yep. Okay. You guys are sort of doing like this fighting retreat back towards the intersection. Oh man, these ants are hell bent on taking you guys out. All right. So there's four left. Let's roll initiative. Franz, why don't you roll it? I got a 4.
I'm trying to throw oil.
Okay. Oh, going at the same time. You do not have oil ready, right? So that's going to take a couple rounds.
I got to have the Link Boy's going to hand it to me so I can throw it.
Ah, very good. All right. So you'll be able to do that this round then. All right, so this is going to... essentially, I guess, go at the same time. Give me a second here. There we go. All right. So you're going to drop some oil in front of the party?
Yes.
And...
most of the party. Remember, I declared fighting retreat.
Yeah, in front of the party. That's what right. I meant. Who's gonna light it?
I'm dead sprint back to one.
All right. Yeah. Okay. Gar's running. Cornelius will probably join you because he's not a fighter. He's a lover, not a fighter.
Same.
I'm sure you get all the ladies. Gilbert, you're going
to get... If somebody wants to have the Link Boy hand you a torch, you can drop it on the oil.
Well, who's carrying the lantern?
Link Boy has the lantern.
Could toss the lantern.
Yeah, I think that's what I'll do, is I'll just take the lantern from him and throw it down on the ground right there.
Okay.
Yeah, I have a lantern in my backpack, so we have a spare.
Okay. Works for me. All right. The rest of you are just going to continue fighting withdrawal?
Yarr.
Okay. All right. So, Hans, roll your fire damage. This is going to, like, light up this area. I'm going to say kind of, like, right here in front of this door of hallway 4 here. And you guys are, like, backing up this way.
One.
Would you like to use a luck point?
Do it, dude.
Yeah, I would.
25% chance of lighting them up, so might as well, right?
Or 4!
Hey. Oh, hey. There you go. All right, roll again.
There you go.
For another one.
Okay.
Well, it's 5 damage to the face.
All right. You hear a ton of squeaking and squealing. Three of them slump to the ground, their carapaces actually pop in the heat as their insides boil and expand. Okay, and there's this one that's still alive, on fire, and in just an incredible amount of pain, going into a berserker rage. Franz, would you like to make an attack with your pole arm?
Yes.
Okay. Gilbert and Kaitho, you can do the same. Okay, that is a swing and a miss.
With pleasure. All right, let's see if I can finally hit one of these cursed things.
Regents!
Not even close. 17?
Yes. No, yep, you got him. No, it's
thank goodness.
Yeah, you saw Kaitho. Yeah, he's swung wildly on that one. All right, roll for damage.
Me and minus three, Kaitho.
All right. And that takes it out. And it just sort of burns. Okay, wow.
We'll eat some rations. Let's rest while we wait for the fire to go out.
Yes.
We can probably eat some ants.
Fighting.
Yeah. We'll grab some
who's hurt the worst incredible. Or who's almost dead?
Me.
All right. I got a cure light wounds for you. Keep you from dying, hopefully, for 6.
Oh, thanks.
By the power of Arn.
All right. Okay, yeah, so you guys are basically back in room 1 waiting for the fire to die out. And, you know, with this door open at 2, you can illuminates and you can kind of watch, watch the fire do its thing. And I guess we'll end it there. While you guys are sort of resting and recouping and figuring out what you want to do next.
Dars. Thank you very much for the wonderful session.
Yeah, it was a good one.
Oh, it's always fun when we're dungeon delving.
Indeed.